expecting.
Now, applications of the Ellingham diagram. Why do we require such a big complicated diagram is that the Ellingham diagram gives us the information about the choice of a reducing agent. That is the main thing about this Ellingham diagram. Let us consider the formation of Ag2O and HgO from the upper part of the diagram. We can say that only at higher temperatures, that is above 600 and 700 Kelvin, their decomposition is possible. This indicates that these oxides are unstable at moderate temperatures and will decompose on heating even in the absence of a reducing agent. So there will be no need of any reducing agent. And the second thing about the Ellingham diagram is that we can predict the thermodynamic feasibility of reduction of oxides of one metal by another metal. You can just observe the Ellingham diagram for this point to get a better understanding. Feasibility means possibility. For example, in the Ellingham diagram, for the formation of chromium oxide, which lies above the aluminium, means that aluminium oxide is more stable than chromium oxide, that is chromic oxide. Hence, we can use aluminium as a reducing agent for reduction of chromic oxide, but the reverse is not possible because aluminium is more stable than chromium and therefore the reverse reaction is not possible. At the same time, to reduce magnesium and calcium, which occupy the lower position than aluminium oxide, aluminium cannot be used as a reducing agent. This is for your kind of understanding. And the third one about the Ellingham diagram. Above 1000 Kelvin, carbon line lies below the iron line and hence we can use coke as reducing agent. You can find the line which is the straight one, only straight line in the Ellingham diagram. From the Ellingham diagram, we can say that iron reacts with oxygen to form iron oxide, where delta G value is negative. And at the same time, carbon with oxygen forming carbon monoxide, again the delta G value is negative, that is minus 480 kilojoules per mole. And when you reverse this reaction, what happens is the delta G value becomes positive, as there is the decomposition of the product. Now, you are going to couple the reactions, that is add up the reactions. You get iron oxide plus carbon gives you iron plus carbon monoxide, where the delta G value is negative. The standard free energy for the reduction of one mole of FeO is delta G3, which is a negative value, divided by 2, because we are coupling the reaction. So dividing by 2, we will get minus 65 kilojoules per mole as answer. Anyway, there are two important limitations of this Ellingham diagram. This Ellingham diagram is based only on thermodynamic considerations, that is the only based on the movement of heat, but not about the rate of the reaction. We have learnt in your 11th standard that rate is nothing but the change in concentration with respect to time. There is no information about the rate of the reaction, and also it does not give any idea about the possibility of other side reactions that may be taking place. So that is your first limitation, that is it is based only upon the thermodynamic feasibility of the reaction, whether it is possible or not, but there is no information about the rate of the reaction. And second one is there is no information about the non-equilibrium reactions. We are considering only about the equilibrium. You can find from the Ellingham diagram that only equilibrium reactions are alone considered for the suitable selectivity of the mass, reducing agent. Here, non-equilibrium reactions cannot be predicted. These are the two important limitations, and this is one important part about this Ellingham diagram. Now, we move on to the next topic. There is another content about this metallurgical process, which is electrochemical principle. We know that all the chemical reactions, not almost all the chemical reactions, few reactions can be converted into electrochemical type. For that, again, we depend upon the Gibbs free energy change. Similar to this thermodynamic principles, electrochemical reactions or electrochemical principles also find applications in metallurgical processes. for again for the choice of the reducing agents. The reduction of oxides of active metals such as sodium, potassium, etc. by carbon is thermodynamically not possible. Even in the presence of movement of heat, it is not possible. Such metals are extracted from the ores by using electrochemical methods. In this method, the metal salts are taken in a fused form or in solution form. As we know that in the solid state, they are non-conductors. The metal ion present can be reduced by treating it with suitable reducing agent or by electrolysis. Again, we know that delta G naught is equal to minus NF into E, where N is the number of electrons involved in the reduction process, F is the Faraday of current, and E naught is the electrode potential of the redox couple. Again, another method of electrochemical extraction of metal is Hall-Herold process. Hall-Herold process, which is used for the extraction of aluminium. First is, we are going to ionize alumina, that is Al2O3 is converted into 2Al3 plus plus 3O2 minus. And the reaction at the cathode is 2Al3 plus melts and adds up the 6 electrons and forms 2Al. Reaction at the anode is 6O2 minus melt and form 3O2 plus 12 electrons. Since carbon acts as anode, the reaction takes place as carbon solid plus O2 minus molten state oxygen gives you carbon monoxide plus 2 electron. Carbon, which is solid in substance, reacts with oxygen to form carbon dioxide plus 4 electrons. Due to the above reactions, anodes are slowly consumed during the electrolysis and pure aluminium is formed at the cathode and settles at the bottom. The net electrolysis reaction is written as 4Al3 plus plus 6O2 minus plus 3C. We are putting everything together. So 4Al plus 3O2 gas is formed. So we have extracted the metal from the ore. Now we are going to refine the metal particle. The final step in getting the 100% pure metal is refining process, refining of the metal. In other words, it can be added as purification of the metal. There are few methods employed for refining various metals depending upon the nature of the substance. The first one is distillation process. You know that distillation is based on the boiling point of any substance. We have learnt in your lower classes. Here again, the distillation process is based on the low boiling volatile metals like zinc and mercury. In this method, the impure metal is heated to evaporate and the vapors are condensed to get back the pure metal. You are going to heat them and they are converted into metal vapors, and when the vapors are cooled, you get the pure metal. The next method is liquation method. Liquation. This method is used to remove the impurities with high melting points having relatively low melting point substances. So this method is basically about the difference in boiling points of the two metals. For example, tin, which has 904 Kelvin, and lead, which has only 600 Kelvin as melting point. And the crude metal is heated to form fusible liquid and allowed to flow on a sloping surface. And the impure metal is placed on the sloping hearth of a reverberatory furnace and it is heated just above the melting point of the metal. And in the absence of air, the molten pure metal flows down and the impurities are left behind. The molten metal is collected and solidified. 25.